So I read all of the Dan Brown books. One of them was called Origin. It is essentially about this scientist slash philosopher, and he comes out, he's kind of like doing like a TED talk, right? He comes out and he says, "I have the answer to the ultimate question, and I will
What
reveal
is the
it."
ultimate question?
Well,
What's
supposedly
the ultimate?
what we're directed to is that is whether or not there is a God. Because you can't prove it, supposedly, whatever.
God is
So
real, and he hates Chelsea. From Stone Mountain, Georgia, the CDC in Snellville, Georgia, and the Wailing Wall, I think, outside of Atlanta, where we stood on guard for three. No, nothing. Stood on guard
That's
for
like
three.
not even
Stand
a
on guard for
pun.
thee. Stand
It's like
on guard for thee, Canada,
this.
3 points.
Oh, yeah, no, you have to explain it. It didn't work.
Oh, Canada. You
I
stand on guard for three. No,
No.
it's not.
It's not
It's not
bad.
bad. It's not bad.
This is like Nemo's dad explaining what the joke
Yeah,
is.
it's
yes.
Nothing's changed. It's the same old, but it is the Five Takes podcast. We are back.
We're back, baby.
If you had any doubt in your mind, no, we're back.
Like Blink-182 with a new song. Kristen, your favorite band, is back with a new track. Two new tracks, and
I
they're
told
very
you.
good.
I told you. I ended up actually liking the last song. You were like,
The two
"Dude, you got all
new ones are
mad."
good. The One More Time song, if you are a Blink fan, it has a lot of nostalgia, and it's basically
Yeah.
about why does it take tragedies, near death events to
Bring people together.
bring people together, reconnect, say the things you mean,
Yeah.
drop an I love you every now and then. And that is referencing when Travis Barker's plane crashed and he almost died, and they got back together, and then they broke up again, and then Mark got cancer and he almost died, and now they're back together again.
Yep.
So they're singing about that, and the music video is really cool. It goes through all the different sets of the music videos they've done over their 2-decade-plus career. It's nice. Anyhow, I know you're a big fan, so I'm leading in with
It's
that.
a very sappy song, I will be honest with you. It's very like
Yeah, it's nice.
meh.
I like it.
But I know it's no,
Very
I
out of
liked
tone-y.
no, the actual last like hot, hoppy song, was pretty good. I ended up listening to it quite often, so
It's good.
this
It's
yeah,
good.
whatever.
Anyhow, the references to the CDC. Oh, by the way, tonight Jack is not with us. He's probably playing volleyball or something. But we do have
No,
we.
he's bulking up. He's
Oh,
he's bulking
yeah,
up
that spike carrier, baby.
for carrying the spike. He's got to do some push-ups, some
Shit, Jack could
pull-ups,
have carried two spikes yesterday. Let's go.
What,
Well done,
what?
Jack, carrying the spike yesterday. But we got Krista with us, and we've got a I believe a high school dance chaperone with us tonight in Jennifer. Nice dress. You look very nice.
Thank you.
She has been doing the Jewish holiday thing, which I know Jack about. Yom Kippur, correct? And
Today
that,
is Yom Kippur, so
yeah,
it's actually the
Yom Kippur.
holiest day of the year, and we are
And it
atoning and
involves,
asking we're asking for forgiveness for all of
oh, we
our
don't have
sins.
the time.
Yeah. No,
Oh,
we really don't. That's what we do.
can I just say no and we'll move on? You can't have it.
How
You
much do
can't have
you
it.
have? No,
Go eat something.
let's turn this into a 40-minute confession. Wait, y'all don't do confessions. That's a Catholic thing.
Actually, on this holiday, we do. It's called
Oh.
the Ashamnu and
Well,
the
I'll tell you
Octaves,
what.
and they're actually called
Okay.
confessional prayers. So,
Okay, go
yeah.
ahead. We won't drag it out. Hit us with one thing. Hit us, give us your one confession. Go ahead, let her rip. What do you
Confess to
got?
us what you really felt about this match. Because you said that
That's, you know
you
what?
said
But
you
that's
had some
positive.
thoughts. You said you had some
But no,
thoughts,
but
and I want to know what
that's
they
a
are.
positive thing to confess. Even with
Yeah.
Spurs today, that's a positive thing to confess. I've got
Yeah.
a few fucking things to confess with Chelsea, and I'm not even gonna get into the
No,
shit.
yours are just gripes and grievances. That is not a confession.
Yeah.
Everybody knows
Oh
how
my
you
Lord.
feel about it, Glenn, because everybody feels that way about it. That's a
We
Chelsea fan.
talked about this. God hates Chelsea.
No.
Yes, he doesn't. Because
unlike Spurs, you have trophies. The Spurs may be God's chosen team. We have very, very few trophies, which is pretty on brand for being God's chosen team.
You know what? Yeah. The suffering, the, you know, you're not getting reward, the wandering through a desert for a very long time. That is very Spurs. It's a fair shout.
To the point where your best guy converted to a different religion.
Our best guy converted to Germany.
Hey,
it does not get any better.
Hold on. You have a buyback clause. That was revealed this week.
Did I not tell you? I told you Levy was going to make all this cash selling him to Bayern so he could go get his UEFA trophy and his Bundesliga, whatever, and he's going to come back and he'll die a Spur.
Now, here's what, as a Spur fan, you're about as you have been wandering through this desert for a long time. You're about as diehard as they come. You're a fan. You're a fan.
Yeah.
You're through. I'm invested. You're through and through. Will you welcome back Harry Kane?
Absolutely.
With open arms?
Absolutely.
If you kind of go through this year of big Ange ball, you have success, or are you going to look at that as, yo, dude, you weren't here for all this building, and now you want to come be a part of this success?
No.
Or are you just home?
I don't think he walked for horrible, crappy reasons. Agreed. He wasn't walking for more money. He wanted to win. Agreed. We were not in a play, and he's got a limited shelf. He's 32.
Is he really?
Yeah, he's like 31 or 32. I mean, he's not.
I thought he was just at like 29, maybe 30. Wow.
I mean, I'm not in front of the Google, but yeah, he's not, you know, so he's got a limited window where he is going to be at the top of his game and is going to have the opportunity to command where he would want to go to actually get a shot at winning trophies. And I don't think it's a knock on Spurs to say that Spurs aren't capable of doing it in a year or two, whatever, but obviously it wasn't going to happen this year. But I think ultimately, yeah, he comes back because, you know, like Gareth Bale, he was born to play for Spurs. And also, he wants the Premier League, you know, gold crown thing that, you know, most goals in the Premier League, which is, if he came back and he plays, you know, five or six in a year or two, and he plays another five seasons after that, is not out of the realm of possibility.
I don't think he needs five seasons at his goal scoring rate. Probably needs
two. No, he doesn't. But I'm saying, like, if he plays for Bayern for two seasons, right, wins some hardware, comes back to Spurs at like 34, 35, I think, you know, in a couple of years in the Prem, he could break that record. So I wouldn't be mad at him for doing. I'm not mad at him for doing what he did. I'm mad at the timing. I think the day before the season starts was a little, you know, whatever.
He's 30, by the way. He's 30.
Yeah. So he's 30. I mean, he's not
37. I'm not old. Well, I apologize, but from behind, you seemed Monty Python.
But no, so I would welcome him back. I think I don't think that there's many people that are Spurs fans in general that would not welcome him back because of what he's meant to the club. He's the, you know, son or no son, and I love Son, but Richarlison is not ever going to be that guy.
Oh, hell.
Sonny was fired up after that goal today.
He is finally starting to have some matches, and it's not like what happened last season where it was like a flash in the pan and he'd score one, like, and we'd all be like, oh, thank God Sonny's back. Well, no, he's actually back to consistent form, which is nice. I'm appreciative of that. And, you know, look, sometimes you catch some unlucky breaks. And that was Christian Romero this year.
My own goal and a pen, right? Called on him. Is that what happened today, I believe, with Romero?
I know about the own goal, but I was baking things, so I didn't see all the second half.
I think he got called for the pen as well. Not a good day. You know, regardless. Not a good day for him. And those will happen.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, and we don't really have as much defensive depth as we would need to maintain top four positioning. So, you know, I'm happy with what we're getting. Let me put it that way. I'm real happy with what we're getting.
Yeah.
You know, okay. I think you should be better.
You're finding your footing. The Spurs are really finding their footing as opposed to to Chelsea, I'd bite your arm off to have the kind of progress that you're seeing. We don't have footing. We don't have feet.
Steve Nichol literally was like, he said the same thing. He said Chelsea cannot buy a goal to save their life. Like, he just couldn't.
Not bad. Not bad. Not bad. Not bad.
Thank
there.
You. Thank you.
It's true.
Yeah.
I would say that we are rudderless, but we do not have a boat.
Yeah.
You said that
you couldn't find your footing, and you said you couldn't even have feet. I'm like, dude, you don't even have a floor like to stand
Nothing.
On. It's but again, I what the other thing that Nichol said was that it's not on Poch. It's not on Poch. He's
no, it's not
the problem.
300 minutes without a goal.
It's really just
You know what, you want to know how bad it's gotten?
I think they need to sell the club again. I think they've got to start over.
This is how bad it's gotten. We got Domino's UK.
Yeah.
Dunking on us.
Yeah.
They tweeted out today that they have delivered over 800,000 pizzas since Chelsea has scored a goal.
That's beautiful.
That's
also, it could be worse, Glenn. Glenn, I'm just going to let you know, it
by
could
Domino's.
Be worse. You could be Sheffield United.
That
I don't know, though, because the one thing that they said about Sheffield
that
was
wild.
That Sheffield,
but that was wild today. Like, eight goals,
really
each different goal scorer. Eight different goal scorers.
Which was a record in and of itself. But what they
taking
were saying
turns.
About that was they were like, they hung in when they played Manchester City. They hung in when they played this team. They hung in when they played that team. Today, they just absolutely went to complete and utter shambles. Chelsea is having a very, very different kind of problem. They have spent a
fundamental
$1 billion.
Foundational problems, like no coaching,
yeah.
No amount of training fixes the problems we have, and nobody wants to hear
it's
this.
It's not a locker room problem.
What are we going to do? Well, it is. It's the
well,
players
it's
we brought
problem.
In. The players themselves are not good enough, and they're not playing together. We're not a team. We're just a collection of skilled players. That's it. I've said it time and time again.
Yeah.
And another $500 million transfer window this January isn't going to fix that. Anyhow, I digress. This is not a show about that crap.
Hey, Liverpool put three very convincing goals past West Ham. We had an excellent day. Darwin Nunez picked one out of the freaking thin air.
I'd argue Spurs had an excellent day too.
I'm not mad at our day today.
Mad at it. Draw at the Emirates. You can't be mad at that.
I'm not. No. And Kat, you and I have a date next weekend.
I know. This one's going to be fun.
Derby time.
Going to be good.
Derby time. Cool.
Yep.
All right. Well, before we jump in and start talking about Atlanta's match, which was very good. Thank God we have a team that's playing well again. Man, it's a very good salve for the pain from that the team across the pond brings this way. It was great. But before we get into that, we will thank Mason Mill. They are a chiropractor. I don't know if you guys know this. We've been talking about them for a very long time, years now. We've been going to them for 10 years by me. I mean myself and Kristen and many, many others. And now Kristen's mom. Yay! She's a patient too. That's awesome. Give them a call at the office, which is 404-321-0082, or you can find them on the web, and you can book your appointment online now too and see all your appointments. That's kind of cool. But give them a call if this is your first appointment, and usually Eva or Ashley or Rachel will be on the other end of the line, and they will get you set up with your appointment with Dr. Cohen or Dr. Farisi. I'm sure they're probably going to be adding other doctors to the practice soon too. They keep growing and expanding, which is really cool. And hopefully once these labor strikes end with the writers and the actors, we get back to work, we might even see them out on some sets. I know they wanted to start branching out there too and expanding the practice that way. There's a lot of film people that go to Mason Mill, primarily because us film types are on our feet all the time, or at least we used to be back in the days when we used to work. I remember working. I remember being on set and working. But we are on our feet on a lot, and they do take our insurance, which is a very big thing, and they accept most other major insurances as well. But you can have that conversation with them as well, and they'll take very good care of you. I promise you that. Go see them. Decatur, Georgia, off from McConnell Mill Drive. Very, very convenient. All righty. So, five word. Anybody got five word reviews? I've got some. I've got general thoughts. Oh. Yes, the chaperone down in front. Go.
Chaperone. Hold on. Wait. I wrote it down. I know I wrote it down. Hold on. I have to find it. I'll find it. I'll, oh, it, I'll I don't know if it's five words, but it was putting on the foil, Coach.
Ah, yes. For those that have not seen Slapshot, do you want to?
You have to have seen Slapshot. If you haven't seen Slapshot, you're not listening to a podcast about sports, because Slapshot is legitimately the greatest sports movie ever made. Fight me.
I think Field of Dreams would like a word.
No. The acting was horrible. Oh my God, Kevin Costner was so like, if you build it,
okay. You really gonna sit here and knock Field of Dreams? Miracle Slapshot.
I like Field of Dreams, but Slapshot is so much more intelligent.
Miracle would like a word. Moneyball would like a word.
I do love the movie Miracle, but I'm sorry, Slapshot, the Hanson brothers. There's not a more fun experience at a sporting movie than Slapshot.
Mighty Ducks.
I was going to say, that was the next one I was going to say.
We went out there. We did our thing. We brawled. We took.
What about She's the Man?
No one even knows what that is, Glenn.
Dude, if you're going to throw a Ladybugs reference.
That's not Ladybugs. Ladybugs is different. She's the Man is where Amanda Bynes pretends to. It's a similar storyline, just without Rodney Dangerfield.
Didn't Ladybugs have like the kid from C-Lab that killed
himself? Yes, yeah, C-Quest. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Yeah.
Jonathan Landis, yes.
Yeah.
Wow, Poland. Okay, Wikipedia.
Wow. I didn't look at anything. I've been looking at you.
No, she did. Kristen did. I'm impressed that she pulled out the Jonathan Landis name. Yeah, point to that.
For some reason, I feel like I remember all of the, like, the teeny bop child stars that died from my generation. Like, Brad Renfro died
as well. Oh, is he dead?
Yeah, he died of a drug overdose when he was like 25.
Yep.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he did the movie Deuces Wild, which was in like the early 2010s-ish, maybe.
Sure, yeah.
And then after that, he died of a drug overdose. Yeah.
Shame.
Yeah.
But in any case, we just went out there and we had our way with them, and it was glorious. I stood there and I screamed for bloody murder, and I want more.
Saw you waving the flag.
Yep. That was. I mean, it was awesome. It was awesome.
But you have some grievances, do you not? Didn't you say that?
It's not a grievance. I disagreed with your take on number two.
Okay, we'll get into that. Yeah, fair enough. Kristen, you got anything?
No.
Shh, didn't do your homework. Shame on you. I've got good achievement, but no celebration. Gonzo said something similar, and I really liked hearing that out of the coach. No champagne. Champagne is for trophies. I loved it. I loved how annoyed he was that we conceded, especially in the manner that we did. I like that. We've done this, but we've got bigger goals this season. Good.
Yeah, but it wasn't the worst goal. Gas. It wasn't the worst goal in the world.
He's not satisfied.
No, and that's
great. He wants a clean sheet. I love that.
I mean, not that we're necessarily talking about number two right away, but at the same time, it wasn't a penalty. It wasn't a cheap goal. You know, it wasn't a lapse in coverage like on a corner, you know, or something.
It was against the run of play. They had no momentum, and it was a TikTok play where, you know, the guy, player made a good run. He made a very good run. And it was a nice ball, but we had no coverage on the open man in the box.
I completely agree.
You don't think the guys were looking for a call? Because that's what I saw. That's what I felt about it. Like
I don't look for the call. I think that is one of our biggest problems.
Don't ever play to the whistle. Yeah, play to the whistle.
You play, and we keep doing it. Yorgos does it.
Brooks does it a lot, and he's great. No disrespect to Brooks, he throws his hand up a lot. Brooks is a future captain of this club. I want to be very clear about that. I love his effort and his quality. It's there. It drives me nuts when him or Yorgos or anyone else is looking to the ref. You look to the ref, you're not going to convince him of anything in that moment.
Not only that, we have not gotten the calls all year. Why do they think it's going to be different now?
Yeah, and don't let the referee be the one who decides it. Just get in there and do your fucking job and stop the damn ball, and then he doesn't have to make a decision anyway.
But in this goal, do you think that this was a case of looking for the call, or not so much? It was just a good ball and didn't cover as well.
No, we didn't cover it, and it was a good ball coming back to the middle, and it was a great finish on Hamdi.
Yeah, it was a quality goal, but it was not in line with the game state. at all.
Oh, I no, I don't. Yeah, I don't disagree with that. I don't. Agree. But I don't think it was as poor as some others that we have conceded. It wasn't. Okay. It wasn't an absolute like Gutman. A couple that Gutman gave up early on in the season were absolute.
Hey, Gutman
tragedies.
Scored yesterday.
I
good
know
for him.
Slightly
good
for him. The reason why I brought that up actually, but good but some of his defensive lapses were absolute fucking boners, you know, and it led to, and they led to goals. So I don't think this was that. I think this was a combined defensive flub, if you will.
How are we feeling about the whipped in balls from Saba? I don't think the receiving end of said balls are used to them coming in at that angle, and more importantly, that pace.
And maybe that frequency.
Brooks doesn't hit the balls like that. They're really hard to bring under control, and we've seen that. But my lord, if you can, you're probably in a really good scoring position.
Is exactly how Jean de Silva scored his latest goal for us.
He's got quality.
Just be there on the receiving end. And maybe, and even if you're not necessarily expecting that kind of speed to come off of it, maybe all you got to do is be there and you can redirect it. That's it. It doesn't even have to be, you don't have to bring it under control and then set yourself and then try to find that finish. Just redirect it. That's one of that's what a winger is supposed to do.
On the Facebook post too, is like, you know, part of it is these guys have had a month and a half. They've had a month and a half. Saba's had how many training sessions? He's not, you know, this was the first time. By the way, I love that people started calling us gas or this is a gas or whatever. Like, I'm all about all this extra gas lax, whatever. G-A-S-S. Okay. Like, I'm here for that. I'm here for acronyms because they're fun and we need more fun in our lives. But this is the first match they've all started.
Yeah.
We have three matches to go.
It's true.
So I think to have an unreasonable expectation as to everybody should automatically know where everybody is on the pitch. Well, I mean, look, I love what Miyumba's brought and he's been here the longest and he pitched a ball down the, you know, across the goal line to nowhere with Saba over there screaming for it. And he was wide open and had no man on him. So that's the stuff that hopefully this week of training is going to help tighten up some, get them some more reps on the pitch, get them more used to where, you know, where to put ball so that they're in better positions to do things with them. That's all going to come. And
yeah, we will absolutely get there. It's the talent and the quality is there.
I think we forget, at least I do, that, you know, just what you're saying, these guys haven't been playing for a full season. It's come good really quick, so we tend to forget, like, shit, this hasn't been that long. It's been a few weeks.
And I think that it's saved our season in a couple of different ways, because, yes, we've won the enough games at the right time to get us into the playoffs, and that's great. But I also think that there was a lot of, I don't want to call them fair weather, because that's not how I feel about it. There was a lot of waning momentum with the fans.
Well, had a lot of diehards that were starting to get really frustrated and bailing, and understandably so, because we didn't have a direction and we didn't have an identity. And I think ultimately when you want to say what we've really done this season, it looks like to me like we're reclaiming that. And that's what I was disagreeing with you on the Facebook post, because you were saying, oh, it's like 2018, 2019 again. And, you know, we're never going to be able to put that back. You said. And I don't think we're ever going to be able to put that back in a bottle. And I agree with what Jason Longshore said on the post game last night, that it's not a fair ask. These are different players. They play a really different style that in terms of just using the wings and the flexibility. And there's a lot more creativity. We had a 1-2 punch in 2018, and it was a lethal 1-2 punch, but it was a 1-2 punch. We have 4+2 legitimate, and
absolutely,
I mean legitimate major scoring threats. We never had 6 legitimate scoring threats.
You're absolutely right. And I really to clarify, the only thing that I was really referencing from 2018 and 2019 was like conceding 1 and scoring 4. That's really all I was saying, is that I am that it reminds me of that, where we were more of an offensively minded club and we were not happy to concede a goal, but at the same time, if you're, you know, sometimes your best defense is a good offense. If you're scoring four and your defense lets in one, you're still fine, you know?
We are never going to influence people with salad. Like, we are not going to win friends with salad. We are not going to win. We are not going to win.
We
by
want T-bone steak. I don't,
and nobody wants to watch us CONCACAF our way to a championship.
I agree.
You know, that's the thing. People want to see up-tempo, foot to the gas soccer. And that is what we do.
Yeah.
And that is what we've been doing. And I am here for it. I am.
Absolutely. But we hadn't been. We hadn't been.
No, we hadn't been.
For a couple of seasons. Yep. So I just, we're at least finding.
We got away from our brand.
Yeah, we're refinding that identity that makes us us. So exactly. The new faces, same MO, you know, original MO, if you will. So that's all I was referencing. Because no, we're never going to have that same team. But what I think about that is that that's okay. We can bottle that. We can put it in a nice little glass protective jar. And we can put that on the shelf. And we can admire that. But we have to move on from it. And I really think that we're doing that now in grand style. That's what I was saying, is that everybody is peaking at the right time. I'm not saying we're going to go out and win it all, because it's that's a tall ask for us. But it's just, I feel like we're finally moving in the right direction.
I totally vibe with that. And it's great to see the fan base getting engaged again.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
You're seeing the traffic pick up on socials. You're seeing, you hear it in the stadium. There's that crackle again. Like, there has been that crackle for the last couple of matches.
So loud.
Even though there were a lot of
I'm watching from home, remember? So I'm only hearing what's on the microphones. And it's like, no, it's funny.
You're right.
It's funny how it fades in and out, because the micro, you know, they turn the cameras and the mics sort of turn with the pace, with, you know, what end of the ball, you know, or the pitch that we're on. And when we're facing our goal, man, it's deafening. At one point, literally, I was listening to it. I couldn't hear the commentator over our cheers. I couldn't, because we had just scored. I think it was the last one. And I literally was listening to it. I was like, can't hear you.
And can I just shout out everybody who has bought into the ATL Ho goal chant? We've been trying to do that for like 2 years. It feels so awesome to finally have like a real goal chant.
Good.
And it has to be organic. You can't just be like, oh, we're going to play this song at the end of the match and everybody's going to start singing it. We're going to make it up. No, it's got to happen organically.
I agree.
It's got, you know, and that has finally happened in an organic way.
Good.
You know, in much the same way that we finally get Bombs Over Baghdad as a goal song instead of, you know, BS Kerncraft.
The fan engagement is up. It's good. We can see that there's more downloads of this pod. This pod is clearly the best metric as far as where the fans are feeling about everything. So it's good. It's really good to see that the vibes are back. The brand is returning, what we are branded as, and that's exciting. Front foot soccer, not going to win everything, going to have off nights, but going to bring that style that when you say Atlanta United, you recognize that, you know, you recognize your team, you recognize the way they play, the patterns of play. It's what I don't recognize with Chelsea anymore. I do not recognize my
you
team.
Shouldn't really be allowed to talk about that football club in the same breath as Atlanta United right now.
No, Atlanta beats this Chelsea team.
Oh, right, for sure.
Yep, we beat them. Number three, left, right, and center. And thank you to Tim Steimer, who said something similar on one of the Five Takes threads. I think this one was on the Footy Mob thread on Facebook, that you know, just about using the entirety of the pitch, passing, he says, Timmy does, passing almost equally in the left, center, and right channels becomes more difficult to compress the center when we do that. It opened opportunities to split defenders. That's basically
absolutely
what I'm saying with three, keeping them unbalanced. We didn't do that in DC.
No, I was about to say that exact thing, is that DC was doing a very, very good job of keeping us compact, which meant that our passing lanes were very, very short and very tight, and we were giving away the ball a lot.
Not the same starting 11, and DC's tough.
Also true. And we didn't do a pod after DC, and you know, we can reference that, you know, if we want to, but it wasn't awful. It just wasn't good.
Look, we got a draw out of it
and have been playing. Yeah, a draw away is always good.
This is the best road season
we've had. Oh, for sure. Since what, 18, maybe even? So I'll take it.
We do got to keep that up now because boy, is it tight.
We got a rough road ahead.
If you look at the table right now, this is, an Oprah Winfrey table. You get 49 points. You get 49 points. You get 49 points. You get 49 points. Everybody, it's tight. And most of these teams that we have coming up on our schedule have games in hand on us. There's nothing we can do about that. Nope. But they are 6-pointers. So we just got to take care of our business. We need to rack up a few more wins, a draw, to really have a chance at fourth. I still think it's going to be tough. I think we are going to end up fifth-ish, maybe even sixth.
Because that's the problem.
I'm good with that, personally. Yeah. I want fourth. I want the home game. But I am not going to be like banging on Garth's door. Where is my fourth place, sir? We had squeaked into fifth and sixth, hadn't made these changes and kind of just happened circumstanced our way into it, I'm not happy. I'm pretty happy because I see a direction. I see a plan. I see progression.
Right.
I'm excited for the future of this team. So if we finish fifth, just outside fourth, okay.
Fifth is kind of, to a degree, not really in the last couple of weeks, but it's like, even the last 2 months. But if you look at the first 2 months and then you look at the second 2 months, I kind of feel like fifth is kind of what we deserve. You know, we didn't win some of the games that championship teams win. We always, we always make that reference. Could we have won at DC? Yes, clearly, because of the way we've been playing against Montreal and against Miami. Could we and should we have? Maybe, possibly. Yes. I think fifth is sort of right where we probably deserve to land. But give us credit to that. We're not, like you said, we didn't just squeak in over the line. We're not eighth. We didn't just get overtaken by NYCFC. We didn't really deserve it last year. I think we are exactly where we ought to be.
That's fair.
I mean, look, there's no, the way the East is, like, I mean, the way that the East has been running this year, like, there's no good options there. There's no, ooh, I really want to get second so I can play. Like, it doesn't matter. Like,
no, it's tight.
Playoff scenario is going to be a really difficult fight.
It is.
There is no easy cakewalk. Oh, we got none of it.
I don't think having a home match is going to necessarily change that narrative.
Well, potentially two home matches, because if you finish fourth, you're going to start that round of three at your house.
True.
Great. Yeah. Then you're going to go away no matter what.
Right.
If you win away, you don't even need a home match.
Right.
You're done.
Right.
You got it.
My point is referencing Jennifer in that it's based on the opponent. Yes, having a home match is helpful, but as we've shown, we can win away and we can lose at home. So for us, I think we just have to come completely at it no matter which opponent it is and have the best starting 11 on the pitch.
It's as MLS a thing as you could possibly
absolutely
get. It's just gonna be such chaos in a couple, like, from here on out. It is like chaos city, and it's gonna, everything means something. There are two teams that are knocked out and they're not in the East Coast. They're not in the East. Actually, it was Toronto finally knocked out today.
Toronto done been knocked out. They're on 22 points. They have won 4 games.
Yeah, they were never going
to win 4 games the whole season. 15 losses, 10 draws.
Goodness. Colorado got officially eliminated.
They're out
today.
They're done.
Yeah.
They're
done. But I mean, outside of that, like, you know, for all that the West is down, they're still beating each other to a bloody pulp.
Yep.
Right? Uh-huh. Like, they don't, you know, there's so much back and forth in the West between, you know, the top and the bottom that, you know, there's a much more even division of points. Whereas, you know, the top of the East, like 1 through 5, 1 through 6, 1 through 7 are so much better than the bottom half of the league.
Oh, yeah, that's for sure. Like, so 7 and 8, like, I kind of like Montreal and NYC. I don't want to say they don't deserve it, but I mean, there's 7 points between Montreal and Nashville.
Well, a lot of this chaos is created by having like 66% of the teams qualify for the playoffs. Like, yeah, the line is lower because we're just getting more in. But this round of three will be interesting. I'm okay with where we're at, and I think I'm probably going to be, barring some unforeseen massive drop off or a slate of injuries, I think I'm going to be okay with where we look to be landing. I'm pretty satisfied. And we're, by the way, like, this builds off what Jennifer was saying. Haven't been together with the full squad that long, and we're still not 100% there, as we saw with the introduction of Jamal last night.
Ooh,
he looks good. Like, hey, hell of a first contribution, getting somebody sent off. Well done, son.
Yeah, way okay. to put yourself. Way to put yourself okay. in a position to cause some fucking chaos. God. Wow, you know,
every new player is contributing, and that was his. And everybody's raising their match to their level to match that. I mean, look, the front office. It has to be said, what they went through, I'm not, woe is them, the front office, and it's their job to make tough decisions and to take flack. And, you know, that's just the job when you're a president, you're an FO, operating it, TD, whatever, you know, you're going to take the hits. And they took some this summer, especially when Franco left, when Ibarra left. That, I don't think hurt. You know, we all, I'll raise my hand, said, okay, and they're like, guys, trust us, we have a plan. Oh, do you now? Oh, yeah, sure. Okay, are you sure about that?
We're gonna sign right. dudes from League Two. Are you sure about
I
that?
Know we're all like okay, so so the plan is to send one of our best players, who's been performing the best, to the worst team, and then go raid League Two. Okay. All righty. It worked. They deserve credit for that. That's a tough thing to do, to hold your guns, to trust the new analytics department, the Loggerway. Garth Loggerway? Way? Loggerway?
Wow.
No. One. Trust the Loggerway. No, that's good. Yep. That's like trust the Midas touch, except it was
yep,
like...
because we were going to be at Loggerheads if this didn't come off. Oh, I got them all night
that's
long.
That's two in a row, man. That's pretty awesome.
I really appreciate everybody who subscribes and listens to this podcast, including just the complimentary downloads from y'all's parents. It's really good. But it's no small thing what they've done, and that's tough. It's a lot of pressure, and that's the job. Look, that's the job. I'm not heaping extra praise. I think I'm giving due credit here because they have made mistakes, plenty of them. And boy, that was a big swing this summer, because if it doesn't come off, you're toast. You're done. We were talking about this back in May and June, how if they didn't get it right this summer, that's pretty much it for Boca.
Yeah.
Has to be, and probably some others, and probably Pineda.
Right.
And now here we are.
Oh, God. We were
up on the end of September.
Worried.
And you have to see how the rest of it goes. But if we finish fourth, fifth, we get out of the round of three, we win one knockout game. I don't know if you can justify making big changes, you know, canning Boca.
And oh, no,
Pineda. I don't think so.
I don't,
we may
I don't
still part with a Boca type. I don't think Pineda really, but. It's come good enough. Whatever changes have been made, whatever Garth has brought, has worked. So it's just remarkable how different a spot this club is in from 3 months ago. It's wild.
I really full-on expected to be kind of just suffering through, like, plodding through the end of the season. And the big fixes would happen with the January transfer window. Fair. And like, yeah, that's, I did not, we're like 6-8 months ahead of the curve as far as I'm concerned right
yeah,
now.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. I didn't know we were going to be able to come this good, this fast. And we were really
another great sports movie. Trouble with the Curve.
Oh yeah. I worked on that. Thank you very much.
There you go.
Got, been there, done that, got the backpack that says Trouble with the Curve on it.
Wasn't that very like nice. A Mandy Moore vehicle or something like that?
No.
Was it Jessica Alba? Like, who?
No, that was
ninth?
Jennifer Garner and Clint Eastwood, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes,
I believe.
Oh,
right?
Jennifer Garner's
totally
not in it.
Different baseball.
Amy Adams.
Was it? I thought she was in it.
It's Amy Adams.
Amy Adams.
Justin Timberlake.
Oh, I thought it
was. And,
oh, okay. Sorry. This is not what's Eastwood. In your wallet. Got it. This is Amy Adams. All right, cool.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah.
My fault. We shot mostly in Athens. and Cartersville.
Shooting movies. I remember that. We used to do this all the time. Number five. And I hopped on Atlanta United Fan TV last night. Shout out to those guys. I really like what they do. They put out good stuff. But they asked me for my three stars of the match. There's a load you could pull from, the three best players. You could go with Mr. 9.0 himself. Just give him a 10, Fop Mob, Sandy Silva. Jeez, come on, quit being petty. What's a guy got to do?
Thiago Almada.
He was.
Could have gone with Almada.
Silva was my man of the match with a goal and an assist.
I picked my other one was Caleb. Caleb just had a most homegrown life. Matches of any homegrown.
Yeah.
The way he's developing, the kid's still a kid. Kid's a kid.
He can vote now, right?
Is he 18?
Allowed to vote?
Yes.
He can vote. Officially. Finally, I'm on board. This November.
Caleb Wiley for president.
I'll vote for you, Caleb. I vote for you.
Yeah.
If you think back way back to our first two games, I was very much concerned about Caleb's ability and experience. And
what a maturation and
open mouth,
the boy's
insert
a man.
Foot. The boy has so grown he was my, in the space of a season.
He was my number two. And then I put the third one out just for AJ from Fan TV.
What you got?
Edwin. Because we were talking about this when the guys hopped on an episode a few weeks back.
We were concerned Mascara, about his ability to do anything
rightly
except
so,
finish.
Probably not going to come good.
Right.
Look, this man has faced serious adversity. Like, serious adversity. Barely sees the pitch last season, right? Gets loaned out. Team that he gets loaned out to, don't want him. All this happening, he first comes in last year in a difficult moment. Injury, I mean, just the sick ward is full up. Tough moment. Loaned out. Tough moment. Club doesn't want him. Comes back in another tough moment with all the self-doubt, all the doubters. I'll raise my hand. All of us, rightly so. It's fine. But credit to him. He's blocked out the noise. He's put in the work. He got his reward last night in a goal. I mean, it's a goal he should score, but I don't think that was a Barry moment where he just has a golazo, has been crap, and then has one great goal.
No,
he's been markedly better. I don't know if he's going to continue starting or even being with a team next year, but I think he's given the club enough to think about. I think he's been that much better, and so he gets a shout out for me for you know just the attitude for doing what Luis Araujo could not do.
I really think
if you put them side by side,
yeah,
I think Luis is technically more skilled and gifted. I think so. But we never got to see it because I think Luis just couldn't get out of his own head, couldn't block out that noise.
Yeah.
And it seems like Edwin has been able to do that.
At the very least, I think Saba is our starter on that side. And if Mascara goes back to being the super sub at about 70 minutes when we're up two goals, he can provide something. That was something that he was able to do. That was what I liked him for. And when he left, I was like, oh, man, what happened to that Mascara guy? He was fast, you know, so
he's not just Jurgen Damm fast. He's fast with a purpose. He's efficient. He's using his speed as a weapon, as opposed to just running at people.
Right.
It's about
I do think that if we want to keep him here, right, we have to figure out how to hone him as a weapon. If he's not going to be that everyday starter, we have to figure out how to take those skills and hone them a little bit.
That man is built to be a super sub. He is built to come in and break your back.
And just run you down.
When you're on tired legs and you can absolutely not keep up with him. But he's got to work on the finishing. And look, he's 22. Good on him for making good from the reclamation project that he was and being probably number two, maybe number three on everybody's list to move the hell out of Dodge this summer. Because that's where he was. Because it was him coming back from the failed loan that made us have to get rid of Ibarra. And that's why he was on everybody's shit list.
Yeah, and it's not even his fault.
This is completely unrelated, but it affects Kristen and I. What? And it just popped up on my feed.
Did it just come in? Are you
that? Deadline is reporting that a deal has been reached.
Oh my God.
Writers Guild and the AMPTP.
I knew it was
tentative
coming.
Agreement. Look, I'm not going to get too far into the weeds in this, but we shouldn't get too excited over this. It's a tentative deal. This has to be voted on. That will take a couple weeks.
Yeah. To, now that they've got to sell it. They've got to sell it to the members
to get a deal.
Yep.
And then there's a whole other guild.
Yep.
That has to be worked out with the actors. I would also like to point out that it basically took thousands of years of Jewish suffering in order for this deal for the studios to finally come ahead. They finally did it on Yom Kippur. They didn't want to work anymore past the holiday. I'm surprised they went in and negotiated today.
I am too. Well, technically, Yom Kippur didn't start until sundown, so you're still good on the West Coast right now.
Jews to the rescue once again. Appreciate y'all. Thank you.
Well,
for that.
Here's hoping.
Hopefully, yeah, here's hoping. I know. I think we're ending on that now. I think that about wraps it.
I think we know.
Anything I've glossed over that you feel like you want to give a shout on or anything?
No, I think this was. It's very interesting to me though how sometimes we're not good with a midweek match. I've started to just kind of. I'm going to say that out loud, but maybe not next year we won't be or whatever, but just right now we are struggling with the midweek match. We really need that time. I feel like, I don't know, but we've done that twice. We've had good games, really good games on the weekend. We come in, we don't do great midweek, and then we go back to the weekend and we fucking kick ass again. We did it with Dallas, we did it with Cincinnati, and now we did it with DC. We've got to figure out how to do another starting 11, it feels like.
I think that this match with Philadelphia is going to be an interesting test of that, because we will be going into a midweek match on, what is it, 9 days rest, 8 days rest, and they will have played 4 matches in 12 days.
Yeah.
So if we can't take advantage of that, and it's obviously there's a lot of implications with the table on that match, but you know, the stars have, as best as they could, the stars are aligning for us with having the opportunity to play those above the table. Right. And keep in mind, Philly and Columbus have to play each other. Somebody is going to leave points on the table.
That's true.
In that match. So, the opportunities, we have them. Whether or not we can take advantage of them, let's see what we're made of.
We have to play 3 teams that are all above us in the table. 2 of them are away.
I will be at the Cincinnati match.
Excellent. And
because I just love Ohio.
And then, so we have to do all of that, and we need help. So that's why us ending up at anything other than 5th seems tough. It's not unheard of, but if we get a draw against Cincinnati, that's helpful. But 2 wins against, it's gonna be tough.
You want to see where we're at? We're gonna find out.
That's a very good point.
Find out.
If you want to see our potential, and I think it'll show our potential.
Tough
to how
matches
deep we go.
But not the worst matches. It's find out time.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Find out or get found out.
Yeah.
And actually, it's great because we can see what we'll be able to see what we're missing and what we need to target and go after in the off season. Because I think all of us know we're not 100% yet. We're not at whatever Garth's full vision of where we're going to be is. Sure. Like he said, it was going to take a couple of years to get there. So let's see where we're at. Let's see what we need. This is the time of year to figure it out.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Well, feels weird to be feeling so positive about things. Riders making a deal and doing well. At least both of your EPL teams are progressing and doing good things. Yep. I don't give a fuck anymore. I really don't care. Until Chelsea shows me a plan. This is what we want to do instead of just $500 million on young players, keep for a while and sell them. Until I'm shown something more than that, I'm just kind of, checked out a bit. I don't even know who we play next week. I don't care. All right.
On that note, I do want to wish everybody today a Gmar Hatmah Tova, and may you have a safe and easy fast, and may you be inscribed and sealed.
I have no idea what any of that means, but it sounds great.
It was Hebrew. It literally.
I know means, it's Hebrew. I don't speak Hebrew. It
literally means may you be. Well, literally, I think it literally translates to like a good final sealing, but it means may you be sealed in the book of life for the year.
Ah.
So that's the appropriate greeting for this part of Yom Kippur.
Ah, this whole time I didn't know how to greet you, and now I do.
Well, that's like the parting thing, like, you know, or like when you last week, it would have been Lashana Tova, which is, you know, have a sweet year. And now it's Gmar Hatima Tova, which means may you be sealed.
Any other important holidays coming up before the end of the year?
Like several. I mean, like in 10 days, it'll be Sukkot, which is the one where we build the huts outside. And then we have Simchat
Torah. Are you building a hut outside? Are we having
a hut? I haven't done that in so long. It might be fun to build a hut outside.
All right. Well, y'all have that to look forward to in the next couple episodes. We'll be broadcasting from a hut. It's going to be great. All right, y'all. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you for going to Mason Mill and supporting them, because it supports us and we really, really appreciate it. We will be back. When are we going to be back? Do we have a midweek game this week? No.
We are off for 8 days.
We are off for 8 days. We play Sunday against Philly?
No, we don't play Sunday. It's Wednesday. Wednesday, the 4th of October.
Oh, more than 8 days.
Yeah, it's like, we have like 9 days of rest.
10 days. Oh, and then it's Philly on a Wednesday, on a midweek?
It's Philly, Philly on the midweek, and then the last home match of the season on the 7th against Columbus. So that's a fun week.
So we only have two more games?
Three more matches, because then we have,
Just three. Just three.
Philly...
there's another week-long international break in October. Like, there's another like small international break in October.
Philly, Columbus at home, right? And that's our last home match, and then
Philly away. Columbus is the last home match, and then Cincy away on the 21st.
Got it.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. All right. Well, then we'll be back probably that Thursday. God, I hope everybody's gonna be okay. It's a long time that you won't be talking to any of us. I'm sure everybody will be fine. All right, y'all. We'll be back then. Until then, y'all be good. We will be back.
Chatul. That means cat in Hebrew.
I got it. I got it. A Hebrew cat.